the company he's been keeping lately, who is in his ear and who is not. So after a weekend at Mar-a-Lago with Fox's Sean Hannity and Jeanine Pirro, former Fox executive Bill Shine, immigration hardliner Stephen Miller, and oddly enough, boxing promoter Don King, he had plenty to tweet about. Attacking the news media, except for Fox News, and Sinclair Broadcast Group, the big local broadcasting chain whose anchors nationwide read a statement attacking fake stories, which the president endorsed. He also attacked Amazon and his own Justice Department, putting the word justice in scare quotes. He attacked Democrats for not wanting any border between the U.S. and Mexico, in his opinion. He attacked Mexico for not enforcing its own immigration laws. And most notably, he also issued a string of tweets on the hundreds of thousands of young people known as DACA kids, the ones whose future, you'll remember, was thrown in doubt by action he himself took back in September when he rescinded the program protecting them. Now, since then, he's promised to deal with these so-called dreamers with, quote, great heart, in his words, and said this back in early January about new legislation on immigration.
This should be a bill of love, truly. It should be a bill of love, and we can do that.
Well, in the 3 months that followed, though, the president has sought to tie legislation on their fate to funding the border wall and restrictions even on lawful immigration. In other words, the president has been kind of all over the map on this one. Right now, it seems, he's in a very hard-line place. He began with a tweet just yesterday morning. Border Patrol agents are not allowed to properly do their jobs at the border because of ridiculous liberal Democrat laws like catch and release. Getting more dangerous, caravans coming, Republicans must go to nuclear option to pass tough laws now, no more DACA deal. Now, in fairness, that was his second, not his first tweet of the day. The first one simply said, Happy Easter. In any event, that one DACA tweet has a lot to unravel and some terms you might not be familiar with. First, keeping them honest, catch and release is not actually a law, Democrat or Republican. It's a practice, a controversial one, of releasing non-criminal undocumented immigrants on their own recognizance, in part due to a lack of detention facilities, in part, the White House claims, due to immigration law loopholes. Caravans are groups of migrants fleeing Honduras, Guatemala, and elsewhere who are making their way across Mexico together, not separately, to avoid, they say, being preyed on. The nuclear option is getting rid of the filibuster in the Senate, so the minority party, Democrats currently, could no longer block legislation. So with that out of the way, here's the next tweet, also on Easter morning. Quote, Mexico is doing very little, if not nothing, at stopping people from flowing into Mexico through their southern border and then into the U.S. They laugh at our dumb immigration laws. They must stop the big drug and people flows, or I will stop their cash cow NAFTA need wall. The president followed that a few moments later with this. These big flows of people are all trying to take advantage of DACA. They want in on the act. The president continued today with four more tweets on the subject, also surrounded by kids at the White House Easter egg roll. In response to a question, the president said this about DACA kids.
The Democrats have really let them down. They've really let them down. They had this great opportunity. The Democrats have really let them down. It's a shame. And now people are taking advantage of DACA, and that's a shame. It should have never happened.
Well, keeping him honest, what the president neglects to say is that his own executive action, rescinding the program, precipitated all of this. He also neglected to mention that he has, at times, signaled he's open to virtually any compromise whatsoever on immigration. Listen.
This group comes back, hopefully with an agreement. This group and others from the Senate, from the House, comes back with an agreement. I'm signing it. I mean, I will be signing it. I'm not going to say, oh, gee, I want this or I want that. I'll be signing it because I have a lot of confidence in the people in this room that you're going to come out with something really good.
So in the space of a little less than 3 months, the president has gone from being eager to sign just about anything to a Twitter rant about just about everything, and very quickly, a factually inaccurate rant. Not one single new immigrant can actually take advantage of DACA, as the president claims, unless they come here by a time machine. It's, of course, limited to people who have lived here continuously since June of 2007. Mexico is taking efforts to control its southern border. That began 4 years ago. Now, you can argue it's certainly not enough, but not that it doesn't exist. And it's hard to see what ending the Senate filibuster or pulling out of the North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, has to do with anything, except perhaps that they either reflect the views of his harder-line advisors, certain Fox News anchors, his own harder-line impulses, and or personal beefs. So sad that the Department of Justice and the FBI are slow-walking or even not giving the unredacted documents requested by Congress, an embarrassment to our country, the president tweeted. He also said this, so funny to watch fake news networks among the most dishonest groups of people I have ever dealt with criticize Sinclair Broadcasting for being biased. Sinclair is far superior to CNN and even more fake NBC, which is a total joke. The president also attacked Amazon, apparently because founder Jeff Bezos also owns the Washington Post. He also mentioned what an honor it was to host the annual Easter egg roll, but surprisingly, or perhaps thankfully, had nothing to say about the bunny. More now on a president on the attack from CNN's Pamela Brown, who joins us from the White House tonight. So, do we know why the president is in attack mode?
Well, there could be a few reasons here, Anderson. We're told by sources that he's certainly feeling the heat when it comes to immigration. As you pointed out, he spent the three-day weekend in Mar-a-Lago surrounded by a parade of allies and hardliners on immigration, particularly Judge Jeanine Pirro and Sean Hannity, who were reminding the president that, look, the midterms are coming up, and told him that basically that this could hurt his party if he can't tout success in building the border wall. That is on top of the vocal criticism from Ann Coulter that the president has been acutely aware of, that he was reminded of over the weekend. We're told that the president was already frustrated that there has been sort of a lack of progress in his view on building the border wall. He felt like he was cornered in signing the omnibus bill with very little funding for the wall. All of this was exasperated with reports on Fox News about these caravans of Central Americans trying to come to the U.S. And so, as we see, this is spilling out on Twitter after he was sort of reminded of all of this over the weekend by these allies. But it isn't just on the immigration issue, as you pointed out. It's a myriad of topics the president is touching on, including Amazon and NAFTA and Mexico, his own Justice Department today. Some may say that, look, it's because he has lost some of his moderating forces in the White House, including Hope Hicks, the former communications director who left last week. And this is the first week that the president is without her by his side. She was seen as sort of a daughter to the president and someone who was a moderating voice. But even when she was here by his side, he still went through these sort of fits of fury. So I think really at the bottom line here, Anderson, is this is just the president being the president.
It's obviously not the first time, though, that the president has gone after multiple groups in just one day.
Absolutely. I mean, if you look at his Twitter feed, it appears that the primary purpose, or the way he views it primarily, is to go after people, to go after groups. It's really his outlet for him, the way that he communicates with people in the outside world, which always makes it more curious when he doesn't go after people or groups that you think he would go after, such as perhaps Vladimir Putin, such as Stormy Daniels. You know, it calls even more attention when he doesn't go after those people because of the fact that he so regularly uses it to kind of go into attack mode on issues that are top of mind for him, Anderson.
Pam Brown, appreciate it. Thanks very much, Pam. Some perspective now from CNN political commentator Ryan Lizza, as well as CNN political analyst Molly Ball. Thanks both for being with us. Ryan, I mean, should anyone be surprised at this point that the president goes down to Mar-a-Lago, hangs out with people from Fox News, and then goes on a hard right tear on Twitter, which, by the way, it seems like most people on Capitol Hill basically just ignore now?
No, I don't think we should be surprised at all. As Pamela said, this is Trump being Trump. I mean, this is someone who, in his 70s, is not going to change. And the accumulation of the staffing changes at the White House have been to take off some of the guardrails, some of the restraints that he previously had. Let's be honest; it's not like they were serious guardrails or restraints previously. And he loves this platform. He loves the fact that any thought that pops into his head can be immediately disseminated to his people. And he's very easily worked up on certain issues, especially immigration. He's been very worked up about the omnibus bill that he claims he didn't want to sign, that it had no funding for his number one priority, this wall. I mean, not only that, the funding that it did had said it could not be used for anything but see-through fencing. So so it was very easy for him to get worked up by what's on the circulating in conservative media right now, which is dejection about his immigration policies not passing. And so this is classic Trump. We're going to be having the same conversation, Anderson, a year from now, if he's assuming he's still in office. This is who he is, and
Molly,
these are the sort of, yeah, good.
Yeah, Molly. I mean, I wonder how worried do you think he is about the base? I talked to Chris Ruddy from Newsmax. We're going to play that in our next hour. Who was down in Mar-a-Lago as well? Who kind of poo-pooed the notion that, you know, being surrounded by folks from Fox News, that he's getting this message that he needs to be fearful of. of being too soft on immigration, that he's not too soft on immigration. But do you think there is truth to that? The idea that people are delivering the message to him that, you know, people in your base are starting to wonder about where you are in immigration?
Well, that's clearly the message he's getting from somewhere, and you do see it popping up here and there in conservative media, which I think is really interesting because up to this point, conservative media has really been an amen chorus for whatever it is that Trump decides to do. And if he were to decide, if he were to decide that the border wall wasn't such a good idea, they would just find a way to justify that and explain it and why it was a good thing. So it is very interesting to see conservative media holding Trump accountable for some of his promises, particularly on immigration, which was such a signature issue for him. It's hard to blame him for being frustrated. The achievements of his first year in office were achievements for the Republican Congress. They were tax cuts and judges. Those weren't the things that Trump really feels in his gut and really campaigned on, in his view, to the Trump base. And so you see him getting restless, wanting to do tariffs, wanting to do something about immigration. And, you know, as Ryan said, having fewer moderating influences around him. And, you know, I think we in Washington know that Congress doesn't do anything in even numbered years. But if you're Joe Sixpack, that doesn't make any sense. That's stupid. Why can't the Congress keep going, even though there's an election many months from now? So I think part of that, you can't really blame Trump for being annoyed.
Yeah, Ryan, I guess the bigger question is whether the president really understands things like what DACA is. He says big flows of people are trying to get into the U.S. to, quote, get in on the act. DACA obviously doesn't apply to people who arrived after 2007. So, A, what is he talking about there? And even last week, Thursday, we were reporting on, you know, he made a speech in which he talked about, and he tweeted about this as well. He even tweeted out a picture of fencing on the border that he said is the beginning of building the wall, when, in fact, we went down there and it's basically just rehabbing existing fencing that was put up under the Bush administration.
Yeah, there's, in the omnibus, there was no money for his wall. It specifically said it wasn't allowed to be built. And look, his tweets were sort of hodgepodge of facts and fiction about immigration policy. You know, sometimes he talks about Mexico having this very, very tough immigration policy, which it actually does. I mean, in 2014, they changed the law in Mexico because of the crisis on the southern border there, and they're fairly aggressive about deporting people from Central America, something that Trump sometimes points out. Now he's sort of arguing that they're letting all these people through. And as you, well, a couple points on DACA. One, of course, President Trump ended the program. It doesn't exist right now, and even if it did exist, it would not necessarily mean that anyone crossing the border would be eligible for it. And then he also made this point about if he had 51 votes in the Senate, he could pass what he wanted on immigration. That's not true either. The immigration bill that went through the Senate didn't even clear 51 votes. So that's not quite right either. So a lot of errors in his tweets over the weekend and today.
Yeah, Ryan, Liz, and Molly Ball, thanks very much. I want to turn now to the White House today and a series of statements made by President Trump that signal possible, and I say possible, major changes in military deployments both here and abroad. Keeping him honest, the president made a series of false statements on a number of fronts today and seemed to get out ahead of the people making policy and, in the case of the military, actually carrying it out. Mr. Trump also amped up criticism against the company Amazon, as well as the president of this network, and leveled a new and somewhat baffling allegation against former President Obama. So there's a lot to talk about. In short, today the president seemed to reveal more than he has in a long time, a side of himself that we and many others have been reporting is increasingly going to be coming out. Today, in two press availabilities with the presidents of Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia, and of course on Twitter, we got a big dose of President Trump uncut. Here he is today speaking about the U.S. military presence in Syria, which he announced last week he wants to end, and he reiterated an idea that he used to talk a lot about on the campaign trail, taking another country's oil.
I want to get out. I want to bring our troops back home. I want to start rebuilding our nation. We will have, as of 3 months ago, $7 trillion in the Middle East over the last 17 years. We get nothing, nothing out of it. Nothing. And as you remember in civilian life for years, I said, keep the oil. I was always saying, keep the oil. We didn't keep the oil. Who got the oil was ISIS got the oil, a lot of it. That's what funded their campaigns. They took a lot of the oil and it was largely responsible for funding. We should have kept the oil then. We didn't keep the oil.
Well, it should be pointed out that the United States didn't keep the oil or take the oil, which is the word that Mr. Trump used to use on the campaign trail. didn't take the oil of a sovereign foreign country because, among other reasons, that's called plunder, and it pretty much went out with Genghis Khan. As for the pulling out of Syria part, you can make a case for or against it from a foreign policy standpoint, but that's really not the issue. The issue is this all seems to be news, or still seems to be news, to senior national security officials, even though it's been several days since he first broached the idea. Now, at almost the same moment that the president was once again saying he wants troops out of Syria, his global envoy in charge of fighting ISIS was saying this.
In terms of our campaign in Syria, we are in Syria to fight ISIS. That is our mission, and that mission isn't over, and we're going to complete that mission.
Well, the president also spoke today about NATO, something his three Baltic guests today obviously count on to deter their former Russian occupiers, which must have made it awkward when the president returned to another favorite theme.
NATO was delinquent. They were not paying their bills. They were not paying a lot of states, as we discussed. They were not paying what they should be paying. Since I came in, many, many billions of dollars additional have been paid by countries that weren't paying, and now they're paying. And they will have to pay more, frankly. They're going to have to pay more.
Well, keeping him honest, the president has long spoken as though he believes NATO is a dues-paying organization. It's not. There's no NATO bill that comes due on the first of the month. But if it's member nation defense spending that he's really talking about, which it seems he is, there's a NATO guideline on that, and the Baltics have sharply increased theirs. They did it to counter what they perceived as the Russian threat, and for accuracy's sake, they started before President Trump was elected. Speaking of Russia, though, the president once again insisted that nobody's been tougher on that country than him. Nobody, ever. Watch.
Nobody's been tougher to Russia than Donald Trump. We've been very tough on Russia, frankly. Nobody has been tougher on Russia.
Nobody's been tougher on Russia than I have. There's nobody been tougher on Russia.
Once again, keeping him honest, this president would be correct in perhaps saying that no president has been tougher on Russia in the last several weeks. He has, after all, joined NATO and other countries in expelling Russian personnel after the poisoning of two Russian nationals, a British police officer and more than a dozen others in the UK. He did not, however, exactly lead the way. And shortly before the expulsion, Mr. Trump congratulated Vladimir Putin on winning what was a rigged re-election. On the same call, he talked about them meeting at the White House. As for the president's claim to be the toughest president ever on Russia, that might come as a surprise to his predecessors.
Shall be the policy of this nation to regard any nuclear missile launched from Cuba against any nation in the Western Hemisphere as an attack by the Soviet Union on the United States, requiring a full retaliatory response upon the Soviet Union.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
So has President Trump been tougher in word or deed than that? Has he been tougher than, say, President Truman, who confronted the Soviets over Berlin in 1948? Now, you can decide all that for yourselves, but now you might dismiss the president's comments as being about being the toughest ever as mere hyperbole, perhaps. But it wasn't the only hyperbole. The president said this about the border with Mexico.
It's like we have no border because we had Obama make changes. President Obama made changes that basically created no border. It's called catch and release. You catch them, you register them, they go into our country. We can't throw them out. And in many cases, they shouldn't be here. Many, many cases, they shouldn't be here. And after they get whatever happens over the next 2 or 3 years, they're supposed to come back to court. Almost nobody comes back to court. They're in our country. And we can't do anything about it because the laws that were created by Democrats are so pathetic and so weak.
Well, as we said on the program last night, catch and release is not actually a law, Democratic or Republican. It's the result of a variety of factors, including a lack of space at detention facilities, and some Republicans say loopholes in existing law. Now, the president also continued his attack on the company Amazon.
Well, you take a look at the post office. You take a look at the post office, and the post office is losing billions of dollars, and the taxpayers are paying for that money because it delivers packages for Amazon at a very below cost. And that's not fair to the United States. It's not fair to our taxpayers.
Now, keeping him honest on that, if the president has a beef with Amazon, he should leave the taxpayers out of it. The post office certainly has. on their own website's list of 10 things to know about the post office. Fact one is, and I'm quoting, the Postal Service receives no tax dollars for operating expenses and relies on the sale of postage products and services to fund its operation. Now, here's another fact that might be relevant. Amazon's founder, Jeff Bezos, also owns the Washington Post, which the president obviously openly despises. So far, the president's attacks on Amazon over the last several days have been blamed for sending the stock market into some wild gyrations of hundreds of points at a time. And on top of all that, the president attacked our boss here at CNN, misspelled his name as well. He took yet another shot at Hillary Clinton and then tweeted this in reaction to some new polling. Thank you to Rasmussen for the honest polling. Just hit 50%, which is higher than cheating Obama at the same time in his administration. We're not sure what kind of cheating he was referring to. Perhaps we shall have to await another tweet to explain that. Mr. Trump also repeated his call today to send troops to the southern border.
I've been speaking with General Mattis. We're going to be doing things militarily.